I know. Yeah. He watches. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Woo-wee. What a comfort in knowing that he watches. Personally, me. How about you? Yeah, that's good news. Sister Zelitha would say, it's the truth. Amen. Thank God. We have come as the body of Christ to do holy business for our King. We have come in troubled times, but we have high spirits. For we know the eternal one is still on the throne. So saints, lift up holy hands. Lift high your voices and praise the sovereign one. Mighty is our God. Holy are his judgments. He's altogether lovely. Let us praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Let's give the Lord a good hand clap. Amen. Yes, God is real.
There are some things.
yes, God is real. Hallelujah. You can feel him in your soul. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let us continue in our worship. Reading the Word of God.
Yeah.
Let's turn to our printed reading, Romans 4, verses 9 through 15, the morning reading. Verse 9, we found these words. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness.
How was it reckoned when he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision.
And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith, which he had yet been uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe,
yes, yes,
though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also.
And the father of circumcision to them who are not of circumcision only, but who also walk in steps.
For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith.
For by faith which are of the law of the heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect.
Altogether, because the law worketh wrath. For where no law is, there is no transgression. Amen. Amen. Beloved, let us cross the throne of grace, every head bowed, every heart, petition the throne of grace just for a moment. Every heart, petition the God of heaven. Father God, we bow before you, declaring that thou art God. Beside you there is no other. God of heaven, God of earth, God of all things, sovereign above all. Oh, we've come to the house of prayer this day, Lord. Your saints are praying to you, Lord. And we're praying with confidence that in the name of Jesus, we have a hearing in heaven. Oh, for that we say thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord, for making us know that God is real. Thank you, Lord, for making us know that we can call unto the Father in the name of Jesus and get an answer. Oh, we thank you, Lord, for this day. another day's journey. A day that we haven't seen before, but you've given us a reasonable portion of health and strength, allowing us to come to the house of God one more time. Oh, maybe the last time, I don't know. But oh, we're here thanking you, Lord. We come with one purpose and one purpose only, to worship your most holy and righteous name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We thank you for all that you've done thus far this day. You got us up. Some, you've given us a mind to come to Sunday school, and we study a lesson about a storm that you allowed to rage, and how you can speak to that. And here we are today, Lord, and hearing the worship, and whether people talking about a storm might happen on the outside, but we don't worry, Lord. We don't fear, because we know you're over all things. You had a purpose for that storm, Lord, and you got a purpose for whatever goes on even now. Even now, we trust you. Even now, we say, Lord, come what may, but we trust you to know that you're our God. Thank you, Master. We pray this day, Lord, that we might worship you in a way that honors you. Give us, Lord, to do that. We pray to God for forgiveness of our sin or anything that might separate us or distance us from you, Lord. We ask you to step in and move it in the name of Jesus. Draw us nearer to you, dear God. We want just a closer walk with you. Give it to be so, Master, we pray. We thank you, Lord, for this day, and we thank you for an opportunity to hear your word. So we ask you to bless our pastor as he comes to preach to us once again. Give him power from on high, Lord, that we might hear from heaven, and that our hearts might rejoice, that we might leave here, Lord, skipping like lambs. And it was good to have been in the house of God one more time. One more time. We pray to God that we might leave here this morning looking to come back, looking for your word. Bless now, Lord, everything we do, from the front door to the back door, every prayer that's uttered, every song that's sung, all to cause us to look to Christ. And so now, Lord, from heart to heart and breast to breast, cause us, Lord, to worship you, to bow down, and we might see Jesus more clearly. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Guide us as we go forth. Bless those that are here, those that are trying to get here. Give us, Lord, to honor you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you. God for all things. Amen. It's now time we continue in worship. As we worship by giving, we're going to ask the deacons to come and set out trays for the morning offering. We're going to ask the choir to lead us in the giving of the tithe, followed by the congregation. Today is the second Sunday. If you notice on your bulletins, a little envelope in the back, it says scholarship fund. So on the second Sunday is scholarship day, scholarship Sunday, so to speak. And we ask that you give, and this is collected and accumulated so that we bless our young people with scholarships, and we're blessed to be able to do so. Amen. Oh, Titus, please come.
Thank you.
Father God, again we bow. Again we acknowledge, Lord, in the worship this day, all our help comes from you. Everything we have comes from you. We thank you, Lord, that you bless us with substance that we might bring an offering. So now, Lord, that which has been given, that you are blessed. Blessed, Lord, that it might be used for the ministries you planted here. And that you might get the outcome and the glory from all our service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Good morning, Main Street. Good to see you all on this good Sunday morning. Amen. Thank God for bringing us here safely today. We come here this morning to worship our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. He is the head of the church. We're reminded in the book of James, chapter 4, verse 13. James writes, "Come now, you who say that today and tomorrow we'll go to such and such a city and do business." Then the next verse says, "You don't know what your life is like. Your life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, tomorrow we'll go here and there and do these various things." Yesterday, we come face to face again with our own mortality, and the homegoing of Sister Arlene Jones went home to be with the Lord yesterday, and it's a sober reminder that we're just a breath away from death. David said, "I'm just a step away from death," and that reality ought to change our perspective on how we live in the here and now. I mean, I want to make sure, like Sister Jones, I don't care what condition I'm in, I ought to be in a place of worship every Sunday. And she had her walker and she came in through this church. Didn't matter what how she felt physically, she showed up. And that's a wonderful example for us that now she passes on to us this morning. So we ought not take for granted that we're here today. Thank God for another undeserved day he's given us. And the breath that he gives us is here. That breath that he gives us is for the purpose that we might worship him. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen. Well, it's my distinct honor to welcome those who may be visiting with us for the very first time here at Main Street Baptist Church. If you're visiting with us for the very, very first time, we're not asking for you to say anything, but we'd like for you to stand, that we may acknowledge your presence and thank God he's navigated your steps to be with us. Any first-time visitors, please stand. Amen. Good morning to you. Welcome. Amen. Welcome to Main Street Baptist Church. You may be seated. Anyone else? Amen. Well, if you had not received a card, just raise your hand and usher's giving that to you right now. And you can just fill that information out and how we can serve you any way we can. We'd love to do so. Amen. Thankful that you came to worship with us this morning. Let's take a moment, because you never know, this may be your last day, your last Sunday at Main Street. Let's take a moment. Turn to your right, left, front, back. Tell your neighbor you love them and thank God for them. Thank you. service one more time. Glad to have Deacon John Wesley Johnson in the service one more time. Amen. He'll always remind you that he is the oldest deacon at Main Street Baptist Church. So good to see you today. Amen. Amen. Our church purpose statement comes out of Colossians chapter 1, verse 28, in which the Apostle Paul writes, "We proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, that we may present every man, woman, and child complete or mature in Christ." And so as we're in this section of our worship service this morning, this is all for the purpose, through these observations, to make you aware of all the various things that are taking place in our church, that we may come alongside the saints and encourage and serve and help build one another up in our Christian walk. This past week, Sister Rose Robinson's husband passed away, James Rip Robinson. He died this past Wednesday. Funeral services will be this Thursday here in the chapel. Visitation will start at 10 a.m. and the funeral will follow at noon. So please be aware of that and please be praying for Sister Rose Robinson. Amen. As I mentioned earlier, Sister Arlene Jones went home to be with the Lord yesterday. And so be praying for the family. Pray for those who had close relationships with Sister Jones. I know Mother Clark is struggling today. I want to keep her lifted up as well as others in our congregation. Praying for Brother Darrell, her son, who's in Virginia, taking care of his wife, who's ill. And now we have to turn right back around for the funeral services that are tentatively February the 18th. And so we'll get that information to you all soon, okay? But please be praying for the Jones family. Also be praying for Brother B. Shavers. He's in ICU at St. Joe on Harrisburg. On Wednesday night, when we left after Bible study, we went to see Sister Arlene. She was in ICU, and then right across from her was Brother B. Shavers. So please be praying for him and Sister Valeria. Pray for Sister Mosina Gaynor. Relative passed away recently. Deacon Gaynor as well has a brother who is ill. We want to lift him up. All the various members in our congregation who are ill or at home recuperating, hospitalized, we want to keep praying for. We have a list each week. 1 Samuel chapter 12, verse 28, Samuel says, "Far be it, I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you." So we have all that we need concerning request that we can lift up on behalf of one another, our widows and our widowers here at our church, our children and our college students. Want to continue to keep lifted up. Amen. Notice a lot of our ladies this morning are wearing red so that men will not be confused. That is not in honor of Valentine's Day. American Heart Association, Go Red for Women Day. And I believe the information is in your bulletin concerning heart disease being the number one killer amongst women, more than all forms of cancer combined. And if I think about that, we think about that, there is one dear saint in our church who was the first to receive open heart surgery in the city of Lexington back in 1960, and that's Sister Lillian Haley. And she's a testimony of God's grace with us this morning. Amen. Amen. Give a round of applause for Sister Haley. Sister Joyce had copied off for me the article that was featured in the Herald Leader back in August 14th, 1960. God is good. That should motivate us to continue to pray for one another. Amen. We have our four-point prayer emphasis, praying for myself and the leadership here at Main Street, praying for our property needs, our financial needs, and church unification during this time. Continue to lift one another up and praying for our church. I want to thank everyone who participated, those who really contribute to our men's ministry prayer breakfast or prayer or breakfast yesterday. On the prayer breakfast, I'm thinking about the Amanda Knox. But it was a breakfast, and we ate. And Sister Denise Frazier just did up the lower auditorium of the main sanctuary for us. And we had a wonderful time on yesterday. Just thank the Lord for those, again, who served us. Indeed, it was an honor to have you all serve us. And we had a wonderful time in our men's ministry. That's how Deacon John Wesley showed up. And then he said, I need to get back in church. And so we said, yeah, brother, you back to church. You'll notice in your bulletin as well, there's information concerning our youth lock-in this coming Friday. Just want to give a heads up that we need permission slips, parents. If your child is involved in the youth lock-in, we need those as soon as possible. No later than Wednesday so that we can have a head count as meals and things like that will be provided. Please, parents, get that information. And the information, of course, is in your bulletin of who you need to return those permission slips to. Our mass choir rehearsal will be on tomorrow. Please be aware of that. As well as, of course, we're still in basketball season, so this coming Tuesday is a UK basketball game. So typically, we move our Tuesday noon and evening Bible study to Wednesday. So please be aware of that Wednesday Bible study. And if you haven't come out to a Wednesday Bible study, please plan on doing so. We're going through the book of Job. Our evening Bible study is close to the end of the book of Job. Our noonday is at the early parts of the book of Job. And it's a manual on what it is to suffer, how to suffer, how God wants you to suffer when he brings your season of adversity in your life. And so Job is a case study of what it is, how we're to walk with the Lord in our seasons of trial. Come back tonight for our evening service at 6 o'clock this evening as we continue through our study in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 7 through 13, the type of preachers that Jesus calls into the ministry. So you need to come back tonight for that. So much confusion on what a preacher is today. The Word of God lays out for us the marks, the qualities of the type of preacher that Jesus calls into the ministry. Please be mindful of our parking concerns, obviously, as we are over here, as well as updates on possibilities of any cancellations that may take place due to weather. Amen. That is all that I have at this time. Let us stand and gather hands for our corporate prayer. Father, we come this morning, Lord God, and you told us to pray without ceasing. You commanded us in your word to be anxious for nothing, but everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, to make our requests known unto God. Lord God, we come right now to pray, to make our requests known unto thee. But first, Lord, we just want to say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For who you are. We adore you, Lord. You are good. You are merciful. You are loving.
Say that, preacher.
You are wise. You are sovereign. You are kind. You are gentle.
Tell him.
You are so patient. You are so full of compassion. You're a mighty God.
Yeah.
You're an all-knowing God.
Yes, sir.
You're an ever-present God. And you're a saving God.
Yes, sir.
One day all of us, oh God, were living our own way, dead in trespasses and sins, walking according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. Yet one day, Paul said it this way, but God, being rich in mercy, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive.
Come on now.
For by grace you have been saved.
Come on.
Not of works.
Yes, sir.
At least any man, woman, or child can boast. So we come this morning, Lord, to thank you for saving a wretch like me.
Come on. Come on, preacher.
We bless you, Lord. You could have passed over us, given us over to the hell that we deserve.
Come on now.
So we want to say thank you. And Father, now that we have been reconciled to you through the death of your Son, that throne that used to be of judgment is now a throne of grace. And now we can come boldly to that throne of grace, that we might receive grace and mercy to help in a time of need.
Pray.
We have a great high priest.
Pray.
Who can sympathize with us in our time of weakness.
Pray now.
Lord, we ask that you would sympathize with the family of Sister Arlene Jones. Sympathize with Sister Rose Robinson and her family. Sympathize with Brother B. Shavers in his time of weakness. Sympathize with Sister Rosina Gaynor in her time of grief. Brother Gaynor's brother who's not feeling well. People in our congregation, oh God, who've been on our sick list for a long time. Those who've been shut in for a long time. Have mercy. Those of us, oh God, that you have enabled to get up on this Sunday, to come to this church. Lord, we want to say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For a reasonable portion of health and strength. You can put us on a sick bed, but you didn't do that. And we want to say thank you. All that's taking place, 70 degree weather, going all the way down to 25 degree. You could have put us on a deathbed. Lord, thank you for the breath that we have right now. And Lord God, we pray that you'll awaken our souls to worship thee in spirit and in truth for both your temporal blessings and your spiritual blessings in Christ. Grant what we need, oh God, concerning our parking and our property needs, financial needs. Be with our leadership, Lord God, from the elders on down to the deacons. Help us to be men of integrity, men above reproach. Help us to be a church that's united, to be united in Christ. Lord, as we prepare our hearts for your word this morning, I pray that you will give us an undivided heart. You might fear your name. These and other blessings we ask.
Oh, yeah.
In the precious name of Jesus. Father, bless every person under the sound of my voice this morning. You know what each and every person stands in need of. May they find comfort, peace, and encouragement in you this day. In Jesus' name, let all God's people say, amen.
Thank you. delivered out of darkness. Into the kingdom of his son.
Into the kingdom of his son.
Not only that, forgiven of my sin.
Forgiven of my sin.
And redeemed through his blood.
And redeemed through his blood.
Oh, yeah. About you, but I was a mess when he brought me out. And now into the kingdom of his son. And I know that I was guilty, but he dropped all the charges, forgiven of my sin, and redeemed through his blood. Mothers out of the senior deacons would start their testimony off with, "He woke me up this morning."
He woke me up this morning.
And then they say, "He started me on my way."
He started me on my way.
He gave me health and strength. Another day.
Let me see another day.
Somebody ought to say yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
I have.
I
have so many reasons.
Many reasons to rejoice.
And I can testify today that he woke me up this morning. His common grace, y'all. And he started me on my way.
And he started me on my way.
And he didn't have to do it, but he gave me health and strength.
He gave me health and strength.
And he let me see another day.
Let me see another day.
Now, will somebody say yes with me?
Many reasons to rejoice.
Our God is great and greatly to be praised. It's good to see Matt and Christy here this morning. Amen. Good to see the saints this day. I'm going to do something a little different this morning, church. Take a brief pause just for this Sunday. In the book of Revelation, just by, I believe, the Lord's leading on yesterday, thing that's been a concern in my heart for a while, I just want to take a text for us to consider this morning out of the book of Hebrews. Those who are able to stand, please turn with me to the book of Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. Just one verse. Verse 17 of Hebrews chapter 13. When you've arrived, please say amen. Word of God reads as follows. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with grief, for this would be unprofitable for you. Let us pray. Father, we come this morning and we bow to your ways that are higher than our ways. We bow to your thoughts that are higher than our thoughts. Bless in this hour. Give us hearts to receive your word. Thank you for this, your church. Guide us, Holy Spirit, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I'd like to entitled the message this morning, Who is Watching Over Your Soul? Who is watching over your soul? After we received the news of Sister Arlene Jones passing, Elder C and I went to the hospital on yesterday afternoon, and as they were, nurses was in there cleaning her up and preparing for the family to go back and see her. We were sitting in the lobby and we were getting into conversations, and some of the saints that were there were reminiscing on Main Street's history, and certain personalities have come through Main Street. And as we think about Sister Arlene Jones and things of that sort. And then we got into a discussion concerning those who have attended Main Street for years and never become a member. And this has been a concern of my heart for a while. I'm in my ninth year here at Main Street. And I think I've had enough of going throughout the city oftentimes and meeting people saying, I'm a member at Main Street. And I've never seen them walk through the doors of this church. And just the way the Lord just kind of orchestrated yesterday's events, as I sat up late last night just praying through some things, and even getting up this morning at 4 o'clock, I really, my heart was pressed towards this text this morning. It's a simple, straightforward text, and I have to share this with you all just as a pastor here at this church. And I want us to be attentive, both member and non-member, of a clear understanding of what God has for the church. So much of what we may think about the church is not that which is grounded in what the scripture says. And the Hebrew writer is writing to these Jews who are undergoing persecution. And they're tempted during their time of persecution to lay aside their public profession of faith in Christ and to go back into Judaism in order to avoid suffering. The Hebrew writer writes and he speaks of the exclusivity of Jesus Christ, that he alone is God the Son, that he alone is the great high priest. There is no other way of access to God but through Jesus. He alone is the sacrifice, the propitiation for our sins. There is no other way for your sins to be forgiven but through the blood of Jesus. And he warns those who are straggling a little bit behind and who are drifting away from the gospel. And he says it's a terrible thing. Well, chapter 10, verse 31. It's a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. As he comes to the 13th chapter of this epistle, he wants to encourage the church of the importance of persevering in this Christian race and how important it is that you need leaders, shepherds, pastors who are watching over your soul to help you to remain faithful in your walk with Jesus. This brings us to the verse that we will consider here this morning, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17. There's no outline in your bulletin. That outline for Revelation will return to, Lord willing, next Sunday. I just want to go through this section of this one verse to consider what the Hebrew writer is saying to us this morning. He says, verse 17, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account. Let them do this with joy, not with grief, for this will be unprofitable for you. The first word in this verse simply is a command: obey. Listen to. Yield to. Comply with. The middle voice there in the original means that this is not something the pastor ought to tell you when it comes to obeying your leader. The middle voice says that this ought to be that you voluntarily lay your heart under the leadership of your pastor as he leads you according to God's word. This is not something I ought to tell you. This ought to be instinctive. This ought to be natural in light of what the Bible says. That you ought to obey your leaders as he is leading you biblically. Obey your leaders. Leaders there means submit under those who God has given you to be under their authority. This is delegated authority. And what he's saying is these are your leaders that God has appointed over you to have authority over your soul. Now, in the New Testament, there are basically four titles that describe the office of a leader in the church. The first is pastor. Poimen in the Greek means to shepherd. to care. Jesus in John chapter 10 verse 2 referred to himself as the good shepherd. In 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 3, Peter says, shepherd the flock of God, referring to the leaders in the local assembly. And the responsibility of the pastor church is to care for you, guide you, feed you. That's my responsibility. To lead you in the direction of God's will as articulated in his word. The second title that is given for a leader in the church is elder. Presbyteros. An elder is someone who is mature. One who is seasoned in his Christian walk. One who has demonstrated over a period of time that he is serious when it comes to his walk with Jesus. You find in the New Testament the church addressing leaders in that church as elders. It's a descriptive title. That this is not a novice. This is not a recent born again believer. This is a person who's been walking with the Lord for a while. And there ought to be something to say about his life, because he's proven himself to be serious about the things of God. Are you with me, church? The third title that we find in the New Testament is overseer. Episkopos is the word, made up of two words in the original: epi, over; skopos, to see or to watch. Skopos, we get part of the word telescope, you watch through something. And this title can oftentimes be translated in the King James, bishop. And this simply means that the leadership of the church has responsibility to watch over you, to protect you from false doctrine, to help you along the way when you're struggling spiritually, to come alongside and counsel you and help you through your various spiritual struggles. Part of the overseer's responsibility is when I stand before the pulpit on a Sunday morning to look over the congregation and watch over and wonder, who's not here today? Who has not been here in a while I need to follow up with? How are they doing spiritually? That's an overseer's responsibility. To make sure you are in the will of God. That an overseer's desires that you walk with Jesus and that you are kept from the evil one. The last one is what we have here this morning. Hegumenos is the word for leader. One who has authority over, one who's been delegated the responsibility of leading a congregation that God has placed him over. This is a delegated authority, church, that's not just relegated to when he preaches that you ought to listen. But this authority is also delegated towards the leader when it comes to implementing what the Bible says in the church. All right. Don't sleep on me. All right. That means that the leader's responsibility is to make sure that he administers the ordinances of the church, of the Lord's table and baptism. The leadership responsibility also is to make sure that the music ministry is singing songs that are according to what the Bible says or scripturally sound. The leader has to oversee all the various aspects of ministry within the church, making sure that we are applying what the Bible says the church ought to be. The responsibility of leadership does not fall to the congregation, but to the pastor. And one of the responsibilities of leading and applying the delegated authority by virtue of my office according to the word of God, listen, is to discern who within the congregation are members or not. I got to know who the membership is, because I have to give an account to God for the souls that have been entrusted unto me. We have a membership task force that have gone through and sought to update our church role. Who are official members of Main Street and who are not? And I believe if you're a member of Main Street and God has given you a reasonable portion of health and strength, you ought to attend the fellowship that you are a part of. But what I want to deal with this morning, church, is that there's a mindset, an unbiblical mindset, that you can be a frequent attender in the church and not an official member. Someone say, well, where is it in the Bible that says you got to be a member? Well, if we go back 2,000 years ago, you'll understand that in the early church, there was no such thing as a person who attended the church that was not a member of the church. There was an understanding that where I attend is where I belong, and there was a public association with that local congregation letting the leadership know, I am under your authority. Am I making sense? You ought to follow the leadership of your pastor. As long as he is leading you according to the word of God. If he's not in violation of the scripture, you need to obey him as he walks with Jesus. Notice over in verse 7 and verse 8 of the same chapter here in Hebrews, the Hebrew writer says, remember those who led you, who spoke the word of God to you, and considering the result of their conduct, imitate their faith. So the Hebrew writer is saying that you got past pastors who preach the word of God to you, and that you ought to imitate and follow through the things that you've been taught. Now that's the past pastor in verse 7. The present pastor is in verse 17. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm going to say it anyway. That the mindset here is that your present pastor ought to be followed the same way you follow your past pastor. Why? Verse 8, for Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You see the connection there? That Jesus did some good things in the past in Main Street's history, but that same Jesus that was yesterday is the same Jesus that's today. He still got work going on in Main Street. And even though the pastors of the past are not here anymore, the same Jesus is the head of Main Street Baptist Church. And what he has placed over his church, you ought to follow. Have I got a witness? There's no room to say, well, my favorite pastor in the past is no longer here. Therefore, I'm free to do whatever I want to do. That's not what the Bible says here. Imitate their faith. Follow them. Do what they did or how they taught you, your former pastor. But Jesus today also gave you a new pastor, or a present pastor, better way of saying it in this context. And you ought to obey him. Acts chapter 20, verse 28, Paul writes, be on guard for yourselves, elders, and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. All right. See, you didn't elect me here. The Holy Spirit made me the overseer. The one who watches over your soul. I didn't make myself the pastor of this church. The Lord did. And I'm responsible to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. Notice this. He says, he continues, obey your leaders. And he says, is submit to them. Yield to their authority. This verb is only used here in the New Testament. A congregation should be characterized by a pattern of obedience to godly leadership. Notice the command is in the present tense in the original, to continually yield to the leadership's authority as they're leading you spiritually. There has been at times I've noticed people who refuse to obey what this text clearly says. For a number of reasons, they feel justified not to do it. One may be personal preference. Pastor's leadership style is not what I'm used to. I just don't like the way the pastor does things. His philosophy of ministry is just different from what we're used to here at Main Street. And some will take that personal preference as a license to not submit. But your submission here is not contingent upon based on whether you like the way the pastor does things or not. Am I by myself? Or some might refuse to submit because their reason or justification is based on the previous pastors. And since your pastor who passed on is not here no more, you don't have to submit to the present pastor. That his philosophy of ministry is different. And therefore, I just can't follow him. Or thirdly, we go from personal preference to previous pastor to the priesthood of the believer. And the reformers developed the biblical concept of the priesthood of the believer. And that simply means that you have access to God directly. You ain't got to go through a priest. This is according to the heir of the Roman Catholic Church. You would go to a priest and confess your sins. You go to a priest and seek absolution. Wow. And a reformer says, no, Jesus is your great high priest. And you can go directly to the throne of grace all by yourself. That's biblically true. But that doesn't mean that you don't need a pastor. Well, since I can go to God all by myself through Jesus, therefore I don't need a shepherd over my life. No, the chief shepherd has placed in every local assembly the under shepherd. And therefore you can't just use the priesthood of the believer as an excuse to not submit to the pastor. Pastor here is not to inhibit your access to God, but to enhance your access to God. I just want you all to think about this with me, church. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 13, Paul writes, he, referring to Jesus, gave. And the context there is that Jesus has given to the church gifts. Those gifts are offices. The first two offices that he gave to the early church was apostles and prophets. Ephesians 2:20, what did they do? They laid the foundation of a Christology. They laid down what the gospel is upon which the church is built. And I got a witness. After the apostles and the prophets are off the scene, now you have evangelists or missionaries. They go throughout the world and they go to various locations where there are no believers. They share the gospel. People get saved, and then you do a church. A church plant. That happened in 1862. You come and you do a church plant here. 582 West Main Street. That's evangelist missionary, Pastor Braxton. And then from that point on, Jesus gifts the church with pastors and teachers. Why? Paul says it clearly. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. Listen to that. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of service. You don't come to service. You come to worship in order to be equipped to do service. That's what it says. To the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. The point is this: if you're not submitting to the gifts that God has placed over the church, then you will not mature in your Christian walk. That you don't grow as a Christian being a maverick. Living the way you want to live, showing up however you feel like showing up, and expect to grow and mature in your walk. And we're at a stage in this transition that we need to hear this. Because as God begins to build his church, and as we're growing in him, and we're praying for property needs and parking needs, we got to be the people of God ready that when God calls us, we are in the right place. Am I making sense? If you are a member here at Main Street, you must be faithful in your church attendance. You shouldn't just be showing up every blue moon. There's something wrong when folk can't get up who are able to get up and come to church on a Sunday morning. And yet you find energy to do everything else but come to church. And you wonder why you struggle in your Christian walk. It's a burden to me as a pastor. I do visitations and you hear saints asking for prayer and God to raise them up. And then God does raise some up and enable them to be able to now get out of their house. But they end up not coming to church. That's a burden. And then when God puts them back on their sick bed, they call me up again. Pastor, I'm struggling with depression. Why is God doing this to me? And God, you flunked the first test. He gave you another test. You want God to bless you. Then when he blesses you, then you turn your back on God. And God says, okay, well, let me just put something else in your life. I don't think you got it. And then you wonder why my life is the way it is. But even for those who may not be official members, who have not united with this fellowship, you cannot expect to receive all the benefits and have no commitment. I've learned, I don't know if y'all really understand the work of pastoring. I don't get up on Saturday morning and work on a sermon. Just takes me about 2 or 3 hours. It doesn't do that. Within an 8-day period, I preach 4 times a week and I teach 4 times a week. Not to mention counseling, whatever else that needs to be done. I put in as much hours that many of you put in at work. This is not easy. And I'm not saying this to boast or anything, by no stretch. I love what I do as a pastor. I love the work. I love the work. And yet it's a burden that when you do the work and commit to the church where you're at, and folk that are not members of the church want your time. I was burdened the other night and someone requested for me to come over to the house and pray for them. And I talked to Elder C, and I said, well, I gotta get over there. Yeah. Elder C, no, that person's not a member, Pastor. You got to go to the hospital and be there with Sister Jones and Brother B. Shavers. They need you. They're who you shepherd. And oftentimes, people can sap your energy. They want to go to lunch. They want a phone call. They want to meet up. And you meet up with them. You think they're open. And they're like, oh, just thank you, Pastor, for spending time with me. And they go on their merry way. And I'm like, listen, there's only two things I do here in Lexington. I got a family and I got a church to oversee. That takes up all my time. And you have to understand that it's your responsibility. If you are not a member, you've been here for years. It's time to get off the fence. That's all right. I know this is what the Lord wants me to say today. And commit yourself to this church. You need to come forward and join this church. You ought not be serving at Main Street and not be a member at Main Street. Why is it so important? Notice here in verse 17, for they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account. My responsibility each week is to open up a directory with the names of all the saints who are members at Main Street. And I pray for you by name. That's how I'm able to memorize your name. I pray over you over and over again each week. I talk to Elder C and Pastor Bob. Who do we need to visit? Who haven't been here in a while? On top of preparing two sermons every week. On top of teaching two lessons every week. On top of counseling every week. Not to mention my own kids and my own wife. And there's a burden that I have. I just want to be faithful over those whom God has given me charge over. And it's hard as a pastor to run after folk who don't want to be shepherd but still want to be members of Main Street. I'm just sharing my heart. And the point that the Hebrew writer is saying, that they keep watch. Here's the reason. Here's the reason why you ought to obey your spiritual leadership and submit to them. For they keep watch over your soul. That means they keep awake. It means that they are on the alert. Same word is used in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18, where the Apostle Paul talks about the full armor of God. He says, with all prayer and petition at all times in the Spirit, and with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance for the saints. I'm responsible for watching over your soul by, as I said, praying for you, feeding you the truth of God's word, protecting you from error and succumbing to destructive patterns of sin, by coming alongside and counseling you in your spiritual struggles, and by making sure you're not forsaking the assembly together of the saints. And if you're not, if you are a frequent attender and not an official member, I'm not really responsible for watching over your soul. I'm only responsible to those who are members. There have been those in the past who addressed me as their pastor. They call me their pastor, yet they're not a member. I got on one of them. He joined. Kept telling me, you're my pastor. I said, I'm not your pastor. And he joined. Now some may protest that the Bible doesn't say you got to become a member. As I said earlier, the New Testament knew of nothing else but a member, not of a frequent attender. The mindset is that you either committed to the church or you're not. To be honest, a person who was unwilling to officially unite with the church that he or she visits every week has some serious spiritual issues in their life. I'm speaking as pastor. Number one, that person may not be one to want to be held accountable by their spiritual leader. They don't want a spiritual leader over them. It's quite liberating in a carnal way for some Christians to be uncommitted, indecisive, free-floating procrastinators when it comes to church membership. They just don't like any attachments. They like to just drift in and out whenever it's convenient. Two, they simply want to be their own authority. There's this pseudo sort of Christianity today going around when people give lip service on the importance of the local church but have a low view of the office of the pastor. They don't want accountability. They don't want to submit to pastoral authority. They justify their insubordinate behavior on the fact that pastors are not perfect. And the issue, and that of course that is true, yet the issue here, though, is just no biblical support not to submit to them anyway. Pastors are not perfect, but they ought to be godly. And so you can use this, they can just float around. They don't have to listen to the directives of Scripture when it comes to their responsibilities to the church. We're talking about our four-point prayer emphasis. Pray for the pastor. Pray for parking. Pray for property. Pray for church unification.
Yep.
We talked about giving and things like that. But if you're a non-member, when it comes to offering, you ain't got to give because you're not a member. That's convenient. When it comes to service, you ain't got to show up for a youth lock-in because you're not a member. You ain't got to show up to Bible study because you're not a member. It's convenient. It's like being a student in school. You audit the class. You go, you listen to the lecture. You do the assignments if you want to, but you don't get a grade. You're not held accountable in that regard. Tony Evans put it this way. He said it best, quote, "Many Christians today are spiritual orphans, children of God with no family relationship. Others are like foster children, bouncing from house to house, never finding a home. It doesn't take 5 years to find a church. We all know that babies grow best in families. When there are children in the world who have been orphaned or who are not a part of a suitable family, we want to get them into good families. We don't want those children to be out there on their own. Why? Because we understand that children grow best by being connected." End of quote. It don't take 5 years to become a member. If you are in the area of being a disconnected saint, you're living outside the will of God. Being connected doesn't mean simply attending church. Attendance is only simply an attachment, but church membership is an attachment, as one person said, that is accompanied by fellowship and service that gives you an opportunity to rub shoulders with other saints. The benefit of church membership is that you will be under godly leadership. Notice, they keep watch over your souls of those as those who will give an account. I have to give an account. One day I have to give an explanation to Jesus for those that he has placed under my charge. It's a heavy responsibility. I have to stand before Jesus. And he'll ask me about every single member of Main Street one day. And the last thing I want to say is, I don't know. This is what he's saying here. Knowing that I'll be held accountable to Christ ought to motivate you to want to be up under godly leadership. I need somebody to be charged over me. I need somebody to be praying for me. I need somebody to keep up with me. I know I have a tendency to drift. And I need a man of God to pray for me and to check up on me and to help me in my struggles. You don't have to go through this alone. God has given you an overseer to watch over your soul, a shepherd to feed you when you need feeding and protecting. Nothing like being a part of a community of believers. Those who can pray for you, those who can check in on you, those who will be concerned about you, those who want to come alongside and help you grow in your walk. And I say this personally, since the day that God saved me at the age of 19, the church has always been the center of my life. I could not be the man or the husband or the father that I am today if it wasn't for the church. I've known in my own life, even when I'm not in fellowship during the time where in my earlier years, there was always something wrong spiritually. Because I wasn't in fellowship. It's healthy to be in fellowship. But if you're not wanting to be a member of this church, I can't shepherd you. My time it really belongs to the time of the membership. Their concerns are my concerns. Their spiritual needs are my responsibility to meet. I'm not called to shepherd everybody at Lexington. Let me say that again. I'm not called to shepherd everybody in Lexington. I'm not called to pastor everybody in Lexington. I'm not called to counsel everybody who can't get to their pastor. Want to call up Main Street for counsel. There was one couple going to another church. They want some premarital counseling. I said, I'll meet with you a couple of times. Looking across the room, they know who I'm talking about. After I was done, I said, go back to your church. They said, nah, Pastor, we're going to come and join. I'm not chasing people who are not members. That's not my responsibility. Love to help, but that's just not my calling. I only have to give an account for the souls. Are y'all hearing me? That are allotted to my charge. And I'm not saying those who've been attending for a couple of weeks or a couple of months, but if you've been here for over a year, and you come frequently every week, and you have not at least come under watch care, there's something wrong. You're not following the Bible. You're not doing what the scriptures command you to do, to obey your leaders. And if you can't call me your pastor, that means you have not become a member of this church. Don't use the excuse, well, if I join, I may not be around long. That's all of us in here this morning. I may not be around here long. Don't mean I should not do what God tells me to do. If your future is indecisive, yet the Bible is decisive on what you ought to do. Do what the Bible tells you to do and leave the results up to the Lord. There's no excuse to disobey this clear command. 1 Peter 5, 2 and 3 says, shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but voluntarily according to the will of God, not for sordid gain, but with eagerness. Notice this, nor yet as lording over those allotted to your charge. God has sovereignly allotted those that he wants to be at Main Street and those he wants to be somewhere else. And I can only shepherd those whom God has given me charge over. Now let me say this as I come to a close. I'm going to say this up front. If you decide to join, knowing that it's biblical to join, if you decide to join, and I think you should, You want to join because it honors Christ? You want to join because it'll help enhance your spiritual walk? You want to join because you know you need accountability and oversight. That's where your heart is this morning. Let me say this. You understand this all up front. I want to have the joy of shepherding you as pastor. If that's where your heart is. If you want to join to honor Christ, grow in your walk, and experience spiritual oversight and accountability, I would have joy in being your pastor. But if that's not where your heart is, if you want to be lazy, a gossip monger, you want to come and be unsympathetic to other people, you want to come and feel like you're entitled, you want to come and develop a clique, then maybe you ought not join. Main Street's not for everybody. Main Street's not for everybody. Only for those who want to exalt Christ by growing in their walk. Main Street's not a perfect church, but it is a church that does not want to live in sin. Wants to honor Christ by growing. And it's only a joy to shepherd those whose hearts want and thirst after God. Why am I saying all this? Notice what he says at the end of verse 17. Let them do this with joy. Your leaders. Let them do it with joy. The church don't need hell raisers. Those difficult personalities. Those who don't want to be held accountable for their actions. Those who don't want to be forgiving and forbearing towards those who offend them. It's hard to shepherd folk who are selfish, who got a problem. I'll just be honest. There's about 300 something of you, probably about close to 300 folk who are members of this church. It's hard. It's not fun to deal with some hard-headed saints who feel entitled to say anything they want to say to you and act any old way and walk up in the church and feel like the church finances is their bank. And if you don't give them what they want, they hang the phone up in your face. Yeah, I deal with a lot. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. No, I'm serious. I'm serious. I'm just speaking heart to heart. Do you understand? Y'all get to go home. Y'all get to go home. In fact, some of y'all, when y'all know somebody in church got a problem, you say, just call up the pastor. Y'all ain't even got to deal with it. Y'all get out of that quick. You know it's going to be a long conversation. And you say, well, you know what? I got an idea. Just call the pastor up. And you hang up the phone and say, thank you, Jesus. I can't do that. I'm on call. I'm on call 24/7. I'm like a doctor. Sister Flo and Emma tell you, they give me a text message 3 in the morning. I get a phone call 4 in the morning. I get up. I'm not doing this begrudgingly. I love what I do. I have a joy in what I do. And it's a joy when you serve people who understand and respect the office of the pastor. There are some that don't. There's some that they don't. Talking to a dear pastor friend of mine, this is dealing with sheep in his church. They want to call him out of his name. And all the things that he's doing to love on these people. And they disrespect him. And the Hebrew writer is saying that you need to obey your leaders. You need to submit to them. Let them do this with joy. Not with grief. That word grief there is groaning. You're familiar with this same word was used in Romans chapter 8 verse 23. Where the Holy Spirit intercedes with you with groanings too deep for words. But this is a groaning not in intercession. This is a groaning of frustration. This is a groaning of vexation. This is a groaning of discouragement. Wow. Have to deal with problem people. Don't do that. Why? For this will be unprofitable for you. In fact, the word unprofitable in that phrase there is actually placed in the front of the sentence in the original in the what they call the emphatic position for emphasis. You can translate it this way. For hurtful to you is this. It'll hurt you. It'll hurt you if you don't obey and submit to your pastor. You'll have to give an account to the Lord for why you didn't submit to the leaders that he placed over you. In the end, you will not be benefited. In the end, you will not grow. And what I'm saying today as I close is that if you are here, you've been an attender for years, you need to get in line with the Word of God and publicly identify with the local church so that the pastors can know exactly who it is that they have charge over to shepherd and help in their walk. And those of us who've been members for a long time, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has not abandoned Main Street Baptist Church. And whoever Christ has placed over me, I need to make sure that I'm honoring Christ by following my pastor. A soldier one day went to the doctor. He was disturbed because he was a chain smoker and he couldn't get rid of his habit. He tried in the past to stop smoking, but he had failed each time. He said, "Doc, these cigarettes are killing me. You know, I'm smoking 2 packs a day and I can't stop. Doc, do something. I need something to deliver me." The military doctor looked at him and said, "Okay, on my lapel, you see 2 bars. Tell me what they represent." He said, "They represent the fact that you are the captain." Doctor replied, "What are you?" Soldier said, "Well, I'm a private." Doctor responded, "Then who's in charge here?" Soldier said, "Well, you are, because you're the captain." Doctor said, "Okay, then, as your captain, I command you to stop smoking permanently beginning right now, and you must obey my orders." The man who had been smoking 2 packs of cigarettes a day for a long time stopped smoking on a dime because now he was talking to his captain. The doctor, rather than going into his medicine chest, reached out based on his authority. The man stopped smoking, never smoked again, because his commanding officer said so. The young soldier started off talking to his doctor. He wound up talking to his commanding officer. When he recognized who he was talking to and allowed the captain to be the captain over him, he was able to overcome something that he had not been able to overcome for a long time. I think it begins there. There are some things that you have not been able to overcome. Some of you are struggling in your singleness. Some of you are struggling as parents. Some of you are struggling in your devotion to the Lord and prayer and the Word of God. Some of you are struggling to get up on Sunday morning, and you've been doing it over and over again. Some of you are struggling of being committed like you should, and it's a pattern in your life. And until you realize that God has given you a gift of pastors that care about your soul, once you get in line with that, you'll be able to overcome some stuff in your life. Have I got a witness? Have I got a witness, church? Let's begin today to get ourselves in line with the will of God. I'm under the chief shepherd. Everybody got to follow somebody. I'm following Christ. And as I follow Christ, you ought to follow me. Amen? God bless you. Simple and straightforward word, amen. Amen. Let's make sure this morning that we're not being merely hearers, amen, but doers of the word. As we stand, amen, I'm going to do the call of the discipleship. There may be someone here today who does not know Christ as their Lord and Savior. They're in their sin. You don't know Christ. You're not saved. Yeah. On your way to hell, the Bible commands for you to repent of your sins and trust in Christ. If you are a frequent attender and you have not become an official member of Main Street, let's not procrastinate no longer. Let's not be free-floating and indecisive. Let's not be uncommitted. Come and join Main Street.
Main Street, we have all members coming up for membership here at Main Street Baptist Church, okay? We have Tom and Nancy Challen, and we have Brandy Jeffries, and we have Kevin Bennett, all for membership.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm so happy to see you all up here. I'm so happy. You all want to say anything? It's up to you. Nancy, you want to say something?
What this pastor's been saying, I'm sorry, I always get teary. Not a lack of tears. About giving ample time to non-members, I can attest to that we've met with him a couple of times this week, and he has given hours to us and listened to our hearts and prayed with us and spoke truth to us, and has been very warm and welcoming, and we are just ready to join this body of Christ. Amen. We want to serve with you. We want to fellowship with you, and we want to pray and worship and to study God's word alongside you. And it must have been meant to be, because I'm not shaking that bad.
Good morning. So I've been coming to this church for many years, and I actually just spoke with my husband a couple of weeks ago about joining. So thank you, Pastor. So I guess Jesus wanted you to tell me that for sure today. But I love this church. Amen. This is the church that I feel most at home at, and I just want to be able to give back to the church.
Amen. If I may. Thank you, wife. Thank you, God, for giving me a wife that wants to be in church and wants to serve. And my time of serving is just about over. And while I'm not here because I'm already a member, I'm coming up on 18 years. I bought my last two, God willing, May 20th. I will study war no more. I won't be a police officer for Lexington. And it was a long, hard road, but retirement's looking mighty good. So thank you all for almost 20 years of praying over me, because I know it was the prayers of the saints, my pastors, praying over me and watching over me and keeping me. So thank you all.
Amen, amen. Amen. It's good to see Kevin up here as well. Amen. 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 We trust God. Somebody else want to say something? It's up to you, Tom, if you want. All right. Okay. All right. All right. Well, I hope you all know we love you already. We love you already. We love you already. Amen. Amen. After service, I'll have you meet with Pastor Bob Brown and Minister Kenneth Johnson, talk about our new members class and take you through our new members class. And after the successful completion of that class, we'll give you the right hand of fellowship. Amen. 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 Good day of worship. Amen. Amen. God is good. God is good. God is good. God is good. He's building his church. Building his church. Adding to his church. And I love the diversity of it. I love it. Well, let us stand and gather hands for our closing benediction. A reminder again tonight is our study in the Gospel of Mark.
Jalen Mitchell, the grandson. Mm-hmm. This is the Carmela Hines, and he's been accepted into a Taste Creek school, a special school, that will afford him the opportunity to go to a number of various universities in this country. And we want to come alongside of him and help support him financially. Amen. Amen. Jalen's doing a wonderful thing, and he has family here at Main Street and that loves him. Amen. And so those who, if you notice this in your bulletin afterwards, if you want to give a love offering a love gift of donation to Brother Jalen Mitchell, see Sister Donna Owens. Amen. She's up there in the balcony. You're going up there. She can't go nowhere. So you go see her right after service. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Love you, Main Street. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you, oh God, for what you're doing here in this church.
Amen.
Help us to get in line with your will. For you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you, oh God, for our for those who've come forward to be members here at this church.
Yes, Lord.
We bless you, oh God, for how you're building your church, Lord Jesus. And Lord, help us to come alongside and love on these dear saints. Thank you for your grace in Brother James Jeffrey's life, keeping him 20 years, watching over him every day, being a shield around him. You're merciful, gracious God.
Lord Jesus.
And what should our response be of how good, in light of how good you've been to us? We ought to praise your name. So we thank you, Lord. Now may the love of God, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit
rest,
rule, and abide from this time forth and forevermore. Let the church say.
Let
God bless you. Love you, Main Street. Church. Here's the entrance already. Okay. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, church. Just one moment here. Now, we have men, in light of our Valentine's Day this week, we have men from our men's ministry. We have roses for our ladies. So as you go out, all the ladies, happy early Valentine's Day.